Thank you, Felipe. And yes, we are very happy to have Jennifer Scappettone for our guest today. What I will do just before reading the introduction and your biography, do you want to set something for people to for the jamming afterwards, or you want us just to continue?
I will say something about that shortly after I begin.
Okay. That's great. All right. So yes, our guest is Jennifer Scappettone. She grapples at the crossroad of poetics, scholarly research, translation, radical pedagogy, and on and off page arts. Her poetry books include Dame Quickly, that was published in 2009, Republic of Exit 43, Outtakers and Scores from an Archaeology and Pop-Pop Opera of the Corporate Dump, that was published in 2016, and most recently, Smoke Penny Lyricard, Heaven Bred, Two Acts, hailing from libretto and composed live mixed reality performance with artists Jude Morrissey and Abraham Agnesen, which is downloadable right now. I can actually send, put a link of it in the chat, from the Vancouver-based press, The Elephants. She spent a dozen years writing about the undeath of the past in the critical study Killing the Moonlight, Modernism in Venice, from published by Columbia University Press in 2014. Her translations of the polyglot poet and refugee from fascist Italy, Emilia Rosselli, were gathered in the award-winning collection Locomotrix 2012. And gave rise to a book manuscript. She's in the verge of finishing, I believe, of that book. The book is devoted to the translingual poetry across media, Poetry After Barbarism, that's the title, Poetry After Barbarism, Fascism, the Abracadabrant Word, and the Invention of a Motherless Tongue. She curates Pen Sound Italiana, a section of the audiovisual archive hosted by University of Pennsylvania, devoted to undersigned voices in Italian contemporary poetry. She has collaborated with dancers, architects, musicians, and other writers on performance and poets ranging from New York, Freshkill's Landfill, to Rome's Juniculum Hills. So, and Jennifer is recently an associate professor at University of Chicago. Are you still there, Jennifer?
You, yes, are you hearing me?
Yes.
Okay, great. During this presentation, it might be best if you give me, if I say, can you hear me? I might not be able to see you once I share my screen. So maybe you just give me an audio yes or no.
We will.
So I just want to thank you so much for letting me present here. For reasons that I think will become clear, it means more than I can really say to present to people who are based in Chile in particular, but also England and around the world, because in ways that I hope to explain briefly, my recent work focuses on the impact of mining, the transnational impacts of mining. And I spent a lot of time thinking about sites like Chuquicamata, for instance. I'm not going to talk specifically about that today, But I think you'll understand why as soon as I start presenting. So thank you so much. It's such a precious opportunity for me. And I hope we can talk about it, and I'll try to, I'm gonna set a timer here so I don't go too long. Okay, so I'm gonna share my screen.
What we are doing is we're showing your piece and then talk about it. I'm just worried about the afterwards.
I think I've kind of set up a presentation, but I think
perfect.
If you want to ask questions about it, Ghazal, or anyone else, as I'm in the middle of it, I don't mind. It's not scripted except for the things that I want, the pieces of poetry that I want to present. So I kept it unscripted so that we could chat about things in between if you like, or we could just save it for the end. It's up to you. Okay, does that make sense? Yeah.
Perfect.
All right. Okay. So, as I start, I want to just read a little bit from a poet named Kezar Wynn, who was killed in a protest on the 3rd of March, 2021, in Myanmar. This poet was born to a peasant family in a contentious site, Lat Padong, where several villages have been displaced by Wanbao Copper Mining Limited of China. And the treatment of this area and the villagers' struggle against the Chinese owners have revealed the dark side of the democratic transition. So this is an obituary tweet from just a few days ago. It reads, "A respected poet, writer, and activist too, one of the protesters killed yesterday in Manhua." A letter from a jail cell. If thieves are ungovernable, if thugs are ungovernable, what's the point of government? Whatever happens to the jungles, whatever happens to the mountains, whatever happens to the rivers, they don't care. They love the country just the way they love to grate a coconut from inside out for coconut milk. I will turn the air blue on your behalf. For now, Father, keep gazing at the plantation you'd plowed with your naked shoulders. Keep singing the anthem of the peasant union. Yours ever, Keza Win, Cell 1, Section 10, Thayawadi Prison. And that is a translation by Coco Thet. This is a wanted sign for activists wanted for their connection to protests at this copper mine. The villagers displaced by the mine contend that they have not received fair compensation, and they protest the destruction of sacred sites and the environmental and health effects of these operations. So I'm going to be presenting a few acts from a project I call Smoke Penny Lyricord Heaven Bread. And so at the beginning, I wanted to just throw these lines by you so that you can have in the back of your mind how you might possibly translate these lines, because I wanted to use it as the basis for an improvisation later. So the lines are, every time it rains, profited whitenessing, proposed wiring. Don't you know each cloud contains choke damp chain cable? Curtail the output, cover all emergencies. So you know, this is, some of this is not quite English, as I'll explain why it's bizarre idiom, but I wanted to just have that simmering in the back of your mind as I present, so that we can return to it later. So the first thing I'm going to do is share a piece that I'm calling Syrinx Spring.
If you want to...
Tohinga o mua, ki te whakamahi, ki te mahi kore.
Una jaula llena de oxígeno para agarrar un monumento cayendo.
一个装满氧气的牢笼, 抓住正在掉落的纪念碑。
Une cage pleine d'oxygène pour attraper un monument en train de tomber.
Una gabbia colma di ossigeno per acciuffare un monumento cadente.
Enter the bi-voiced Syrinx.
A cage full of oxygen to catch a falling monument.
一个充满氧气的牢笼, 接住一个下落的纪念碑.
Our Serenette's little hunt for the monument. Serenus Canaria in Carboni Fodina.
A ventilator for
the climate
canary.
Monuments rise and fall, are cast and smothered in plastic. We plunge the canary into the depths, then resuscitate it. Two cavitied duets of a voice damned to the melody of the serenade. An instrument devised in Enlightenment France to mimic canary voices through a crank for bellowed pipes. The mechanism trained birds, songless because trapped in cages, to cheap militarized ditties of their own demise, such as La Petite Chasse, which your ears just received as our jingle, Little Hunt. The canary, a sentinel species, martyr of the Anthropocene, pet cheerfully sacrificed as collateral damage in the extraction of underbowels, fueling capitals all over Mobius score of growth by death and death by growth. Canary as us, we suffocate ourselves and devise cages of resuscitation, ragged bandages of PPE, heaving ourselves away from and towards livability. At the end of Rome, the emperor and his followers tweeted at one another until they violated the tweeter rules. They burned the forests for the wolves, so that all that were left were the cathedral roofs. And then they burned those too. The ceiling of rotating heaven, cranked by the dehumanized persons, was buried, and 14 centuries later, praised by painters who fell through a cleft in the soil, who thought the frescoed creatures thereupon fantasy, whereas in truth they were just extinct. What have we to say now that the reoxygenated enemy can no longer tweet? Pentagon rebate. Knock, knock. Who's there to dub the silent spring? A New Yorker columnist. A self-exploiting Insta brand. A few poets in Milwaukee. Dumpty. Channel the breath against preconditioned national language organs to come more variously up for air. What breaths left to shriek into the empty shaft? This broken chorus of terror and nest, rape and repair.
Okay, so I'm gonna say something about what on earth is behind that. But if, I don't know, we could talk about it, or I could just keep going and tell you how I got there.
If you want to tell us a little more, we can talk.
Okay. So I'm going to play this. Okay. So I have a couple of epigraphs for talking about this. One is, it comes from writing on a story by Henry James called In the Cage, which is about a woman who works in a telegraph office. I just thought that it was perfect in terms of an expression of the way that we feel much of the time these days, even as a cross point in a network vibrating with information she has learned next to nothing. And my other epigraph actually comes from a conversation that I had with C.S. Giscombe, who was a poet who also ran trains and happened to run trains through the wire complex that I'm going to talk about in a moment in Pennsylvania. I was telling him that this project was meant to mount an oblique indictment to the education system for not answering the question, what's across the street? And C.S. Giscombe's response to me was, that's a big question, what's across the street? So this is an image that I found while in the midst of this project that I'm going to present. It's an image of that my mother took of the people in my elementary school competing against one another on field day in 1984 1984. And this was the year and in fact the month that it was found that the site beyond the fence was one of the most toxic in the United States. It was immediately adjacent to both the house where I grew up and the elementary school itself. And you can see garbage trucks and you can also see a water tower there. And I found it quite delightful in a kind of perverted way that we were being trained to be healthy, athletic people while totally unaware of what was on the other side of the fence. That water tower belonged to a company called Ciro Wire, and it fell in 2005, which is when I started this project. I started it because my mother was undergoing chemotherapy and I decided to do some research into the site to see why I had grown up in a cancer cluster. I didn't know much about the area where I grew up. There was a fence there and you could see some stuff beyond the fence. They covered up the fence over the last 10 years with this attractive Christmas tree looking stuff. So it's a new and improved fence now. It doesn't do much to keep contaminants out. What I learned soon after starting the research was that that area was a so-called Superfund site. It was a landfill that had been a set aside by the Environmental Protection Agency for money for cleanup since it was deemed to be one of the most toxic in the United States. And there were various kinds of studies that came out in the interim about the links between Long Island and breast cancer that were inconclusive. I grew up in the place indicated by the blue arrow, and you can see that this is something I got out of an EPA report. You can see that there was a wire company there and then an incinerator and some layers of a landfill. And this is what the site looked like years later when they were trying to reclaim the land. So I set about in around the year 2005 to try to figure out what was below the ground in the area that I grew up in. And it was a kind of infernal task. I took Lewis Carroll's Alice's Adventures Underground as a prompt, and I actually decided to sample the nonsense logics of his work for the pieces that I started to write about this site. For a long time, the project was called Exit 43. A lot of the poems ended up in a book called The Republic of Exit 43, Outtakes and Scores from an Archaeology and Pop-Up Opera of the Corporate Dump. And they surrounded landfills, specifically the landfill across the street, but also notorious landfills like Freshkill's landfill on Staten Island in New York. So I'll read you a few of the poems from this project, which slid into a book project that's still in progress. I see them as a kind of diptych. The poems were made by cutting up Alice in Wonderland and all the different various inconclusive EPA reports, the text of court cases, the text of websites from a number of corporate polluters, including most centrally this company called Zero Wire, which was a copper rod mill. And so for much of the progress of these pieces, I was kind of working in the dark. I was writing poems about something that I didn't understand. And I was writing poems as much about the dizzying process of trying to find out what had happened across the street as they were about what happened across the street, if you know what I mean. They're pointedly trying to be difficult to read. And so I like performing them in public because they're not exactly linear. So I'll just read a few of them for you now. Barrow full of what? Rome. No, that's a good many voices, hundreds of thousands downwards. Moan them down, crushed them with tolls or fever airs, lessons to learn. A murmur of folk and associated logos, earnest money rattling in, low creeping in the schoolroom. Travel tarnished of more energetic remedies. Either the well was very deep, rout early gathered acute snow sea, and in that case, luckily the salt water has followed the red creaming collaborator and swam slowly, shedding gallons, quite natural, but shut stands the door, or stored in a retrieval system, latitude or longitude, I've got shamed, sadly down the middle, shamed. Monstrable seas in trunk exchange, choked and had children digging pretexts, they all moved to the shore, growing and growing, and very soon, was no one way went Alice to the global shit list. Wormy clouds over Manhattan, distinguished acres of litigious grounds. These mortality patterns also well begotten and raised by a perfect mother. Exposed to beta benzene hexachloride, also eternal progress. Not to encumber his poem with too much business. Starting from fish-shaped pomanok, potential exposures so far off, oh, to the global shit list, and the dark earth resounded about them as they distinguished acres of litigious grounds. These mortality patterns also well begotten and raised by a perfect mother. Recycling at its best, said Zucker, also firms of wall, for shutting people up, fatten, pristine, eternal progress, not to encumber his poem with too much business. The poor girl looked down at her rags and in few years with her unnatural wounds, generated interest, concern, and activity on behalf of a silent world of which we have become the agents. The poor girl looked down at her rags and in few years with her unnatural wounds imprinted will depend on volumes of electronically stored information in BP's control. After roaming many lands, the Camorra fruits and vegetables, table one, box four, aren't completely understood. The existing data shall vex the thrashing floor. 4 feet of clean, sandy fill. Most of the flooring flies. Oil spill thus coils the ESI ebb and flow to temporarily close. 4, rely on your vendor. 6, if all else fails, go to court. Even if my head would have sung, whilst mighty Caesar in his war, the Camorra shall vex the thrashing floor, 4 feet of clean sandy fill. Most of ire automatically receives and records information on our server. The flooring flies ire through our contact page to temporarily close ESI. She vanished there. Euridicen toto referabant flumine ripai. So I was working a lot with the idea of pulling these lines into the public space in some way. My collaborator, Judd Morrissey, actually programmed some of these lines to move into an AR app that was virtually installed over the landfill so that you would be seeing these from the periphery of the site, you know, like over the barbed wire fence. Other things that I was playing with at the time of this work were working with the actual language of garbage and in collaboration with a choreographer named Kathy Westwater. I was designing these poetic scores for different kinds of temporary poems slash assemblages that could be draped around performers and become difficult reading instruments. In this case, what I'm showing here is actually some images from Pratt Institute, where we had the students gather the language of their garbage, and that was interspersed with lines that I had written while doing field work at Fresh Kills Landfill. So all of this was sort of mixing together and becoming a series of poems that I had no idea whether my publisher, Atelos, would actually be able to publish these, because they're in full color. They ended up doing that, which was kind of a miracle. And Edwin Torres is here and knows that they're very generous in terms of finding ways to make it possible to make books out of work that doesn't conform as easily to some of the standards of publishability in books. So these poems, you know, pulled together not only the words of the research I was doing, but also images. So like here, I'm combining images of utopian landscapes with images of the actual machinery of Fresh Kills Landfill. I did some, a bunch of field work there together with the dancers, and trying to make the whole come together in what I imagine to be these pop-up windows. So I imagine these visual pieces to be almost like the annoying pop-up windows that show up when you're trying to browse and you're hit with an advertisement. It doesn't happen as much now. When I started the project, pop-up windows were harder to suppress. And the idea would be that they would be kind of lyrical in a way that was, let's say, trying to drag you in to this nefarious reality in a way. So lulling you in with their lyricism and with their colors, but somehow trying to turn the language of what was happening underground to turn it up, to expose it, and to turn the corporate rhetoric around what it means to divest oneself of responsibility for one's tailings or, you know, waste against itself. So I want to talk a little bit about the project that led away from this. In this map, I have this map that I found through the EPA website, and you can see former Ciro Wire and Cable Company site demolished in 2005. That was when I moved back to New York after many years away and I started this research. So that site was demolished. And yet I really wanted to know what happened there. Because they were the main polluters in the landfill that you see in this image. And the blue arrow at the bottom is the location of my house and then the location of the elementary school. What I found out was that this wire company had actually milled the wire for buildings as important as the World Trade Center. I started finding out about the special kinds of cable and wire that they produced there. And I eventually found this image, which makes it seem as though there's a kind of smelting operation right on the site of my childhood home. This was a really alarming image to come across on through the New York State Archives. But even more discomposing to me was that I found the annual reports of the Ciro Corporation online. They had been digitized by the Cleveland Public Library. And I discovered that this was created by the likes of Phoebe Hearst and Henley Clay Frick. And that the place where the copper came from was actually the Peruvian Andes. And you can see here that the operations are in that are in the north are depending on these areas in the south. So in Chile, the Rio Blanco copper property awaiting commercial development, southern Peru and central Peru. And I found this image of the smelting town La Oroya and of these students that were studying through a grant made possible. Well, I found out that this is what the place looks like now and that it's actually the mine is eating the actual town and displacing people. That there are mining wastes that repeatedly just blow into people's bodies, literally, and lead to a host of health problems, including developmental disabilities. I actually found that this company's smelting operation was named one of the world's worst polluted places. So in La Oroya, Peru. And this was at the end of like pulling my book together, The Republic of Exit 43 together. And I realized that there was way too much here to just stop and that there was a whole other book project embedded in this having to do with the global copper problem. I found this The Conduct of the Cerro de Pasco Mining Company by Dora Meyer of the Asociación Pro Indígena. I also found that there are activists working there right now to try to expose what is happening to the communities and to the landscape around. This is separate your trash. It's a temporary installation that's meaning to make fun of the way that you would possibly separate the arsenic and the, lead and the mercury and the general acids out of your garbage. And this is Miss Cerro de Pasco. So she is declaring an environmental emergency in the place. So this got me to thinking, I'm kind of identified with this movement called ecopoetics, but I'm more fond of the term geopoetics since it leads into geography and geopolitics and to geology, which we can understand as a relation of power that continues to constitute racialized relations of power in the Anthropocene. Along the way, I also learned that the salvage of copper is itself a very polluting operation, that many times in e-waste dumps, like the one at Agbogbloshie in Accra, kids are doing this work to pay for school books. This is actually something that my great-grandfather did in East Harlem. He also salvaged copper wire by burning it. It's very bad for one's health. And so I began to be very interested in exposing the kind of substrate of this thing we call the internet and this thing we call the cloud. The substrate, this is a server farm. Looks like it's a very ethereal place that we're meeting in today, but it actually, and there's this idea, this futurist idea that it's all wireless, but it's very much wired. This is a image of the laying of the first transatlantic telegraph cable, and they were much more aware at that time of the presence of these cables than we are today. We were not always aware of the infrastructure of the telecommunications that make it possible for us to meet in the cloud, or the location of the world's copper deposits. So this project is trying to kind of hack into this idea, you know, of the cloud as being this thing made of zeros and ones. And this is a Facebook server farm. And to try to rethink and think against the idea of pennies from heaven, I've become obsessed with the Bing Crosby song, Pennies from Heaven, which came out during the Great Depression. And it's a genius, like in terms of its lyrics, but I'm not going to play it for you right now. I'll just say that it's at the basis of this book that I'm writing right now. So here's an image of all the copper wiring that was exposed after Hurricane Sandy left Verizon's cable vaults flooded. My idea for this book is that you could kind of expose all the copper infrastructure, all the wiring, and sort of sound this global lyre made out of copper. And think of all of the creatures that you could charm with that and the awareness that you would be able to institute as a result. So I'm just showing a few images here of the progression of this research. I've done some work in this site, 601 North, which was a house/gallery where the walls were stripped, so you were actually able to see all the copper pipes and the copper wires. I've done research in sites of copper extraction, copper boom and bust from the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. These are some images there of sites that have been, you know, exploited and then left behind. This is a Tohono O'odham Nation leased copper mine in Arizona and its workings. This is near Bisbee, Arizona, and this is practically on the U.S.-Mexico border. It's aptly called the Smelter Cemetery of El Paso from Asarco Copper Company. And thinking about the lives of the laborers here, this is a publicity photo that says the greatest safety device in the world is a careful worker. And thinking about how people like Trump make the copper economy go boom or bust. So I'm going to read you a rather short poem that's originally made to be performed on an iPad. And the way that you would progress is by jerking the iPad from one side to the next. Because of my internet connection today, I'm gonna just run through the slides instead of doing this in order to get to the next line. And I'm just gonna say that this poem is called One Man Drill. And it's about these economizing measures that were taken that led to strikes. There was a one-man drill that was instituted in around 1913 that the laborers struck against because they understood that it would cut the labor force in half and be more dangerous. And that started a tremendous labor crisis up here in up north Michigan. And what I'm working with in this piece is the language of mining and telegraph code books. And this is like a sort of primitive way of encoding telecommunications. So you would have these really expensive code books that only mining companies could afford, not the workers or anything. And they would take, you know, any kind of language that we would normally need to use to run a mine and make up new words for it. So this was a way of making the messages more confidential and secure. So you can see here, this is a telegram that was sent in 1913 about strikers. So we have the sentence, for instance, hell bore attitude if I wondrous metal coil of subjugationers, which has been decoded in red. So hell bore means he, attitude means asked, subjugationers means strikers. So this sentence means he asked if I would meet committee of strikers. So it turns out that the language of these code books is sort of amazingly poetic. And it tells us a lot about what these people had on their minds. It also almost works against itself. So on this page of the code book, I'm showing an area where it says lament. That's the code word for the mine has been opened up well. And here we have the word investment means we have a good deal of difficulty with the natives. So I've been making these poems that utilize these code words and then that decode them in order to sort of tap into this almost unconscious of the extraction economy. So here you can see there's this sentence, snowy rosetting arson south radius and arson misdirects to the numerous, which means some rioting at south range and at mines to the north. So just to show you what's behind words like this, every time it rains, in this case, profited is the code word for proposed, and whitenessing is the code word for wiring. And don't you know each cloud contains choke damp is the code word for curtail the output, and chain cable is the code word for cover all emergencies, which is apparently something that these folks needed to have in their code book, because it would probably be necessary to cover all emergencies. So I'm going to read this little section of this piece and share one additional piece with you before we just talk about stuff. Okay, so again, this would normally be on an app, and I would progress to the next line by jerking the device. This is an app that my collaborators, Judd Morrissey, the code and performance and poetic artist, and Abraham Avnizan, the artist technologist, made possible. One man drill. Every time it rains beastly bath bricks, blasting bonanzas have been struck. So all the italics are the translations of the all caps, which are the code words from this mining code book. Don't you know each cloud contains denonymous bellitude, escape, don't consider business safe. Every time it rains draconic air drills. A well-known and most respectable firm will not pay in advance. Don't you know each stope contains gripe penny brokerage, liberty to act as banks think proper, one man widow makers, air drill soliloquies, gangs of shuddering copper wire undesirables, smoke penny lyricord deads heave, last year by constant penetration encroaching on the reserve. Every time it rains jaw rope lynch law, news quite correct pending the hearing of the case. Don't you know each gouge contains boom and bust of nitro lungs? Don't you know each crowd contains asphyxial umbrageous evensong, memorandum of association shall require a hoisting engine of 5,300 horsepower. Pennyweight hellhound, hope soon to be making lyricisms, hue hole, melody, market in a downward tendency now presents a better appearance. You'll find your fortune fallen all over town. Subjugationers disobeyeth, strikers have not yet fallen. Be sure that your unshowered is uprising downpour. Be sure that your 6% profit is 800% fire damp in the mine. Save them for a pack horse of sunstroke and flowerage. Save them for a sale of 23,250 ores will be assured and inform us by telegraph at once. If you want the things you love match, unless you can get patents, bathing by blasting, you must have showers. Outspoken, rise, backfaller, the battery returns, noise in the wires. So when you hear it and thunder showing traces of gold, bath metal, much blasting is needed, disorderly stocks continue falling, don't run under a tree. There'll be a one-man drill, our agitator, dropping a dit and a din in the odious machine for you and me. Okay, so I'm just gonna show one more piece from this work. These are some images of what it looks like when all these different apps are put into motion and installed in a space. This is what that app looked like. It was hanging from a ceiling reading, "Agitate me." And once agitated, it would show people the poem. And so I'm going to talk about this little piece that I'll share with you to close called Pennies from Nether, which also draws on the language of these code books. Nether in mining terminology, it means a fault or a stress of uncapitalizable material, but of course it also means designating what lies beneath the earth, native to hell or the underworld. So I'm still playing with this idea of pennies from heaven. And one of the things that I was interested in doing was imagining a different kind of collective. This is a sign meant to boost copper production at the Anaconda Copper Mining Company in Butte, Montana, in the midst of World War II. And it basically is a really racist, you know, depiction of the enemies, and refers to its work, the work of copper mining, as war production, and it designates how many employees have absented themselves from the war production. Were you one of them with that kind of Uncle Sam index finger? In the meantime, the industrial workers of the world were imagining different kinds of collectivity, and they were actually instrumental in mobilizing a bunch of strikes and shutdowns of the copper industry, precisely because it was such an important part of the war effort, particularly in World War I when it was really crushed. But they continued to do so. And one of the ways that they did this was by translation. I came upon the work of a poet named Arturo Giovannitti, who was born in Italy and died in the Bronx. He's best remembered for his work organizing the 1912 Bread and Roses strike. I found his work in the IWW archives, and he was responsible for translating a number of texts in the Little Red Songbook and also pamphlets. So this project has me thinking about the work of translation in forging a global solidarity that is different from the transnational kind that is imposed from above or by the capitalist system. And so what I've done here is I've invited a number of friends, and I'm gonna invite you in a few minutes to translate these lines. And I have married each of these friends to a penny that falls from the sky in an augmented reality app. Again, all this being part of the work with my co-conspirators, Judd Morrissey and Abraham Avnizan. So these are all the translators that worked on the piece that I'm about to share with you. So it's an app, and it's meant to make you see infrastructure differently if you look at infrastructure through these eyes. It makes rain appear. So I'm going to just show you that. I'm gonna stop my share and restart it for this last couple minutes piece. And what this is I took the app for a walk yesterday at 3 because I thought that it would be a little too dicey for me to do it live with you. And I was in fact right because of the windstorm and everything. So yesterday at 3, I took the app for a walk and I recorded my screen. So this isn't a video, properly speaking. It's kind of a showing you what it would look like if you had the app in your hands, which one day we want to make it downloadable, but for the moment it has lived in installation contexts. And one of the things I love about this piece is that I hear the voices of my friends. You may even recognize some of them. in a different language from the English language that we almost by injunction always are interacting in. And I get to know the lines and I get to know their voice in another language.
Cada vez que llueva, llueva blancura y hay ganancias en la...
Hopote brechei, brechei to kertaleon, to aspra marturema.
Omnit.
Immer wenn es regnet.
Saher bieshi, bieshi me te ardhurat të bardhit.
Fi kulli marratin tumtër...
Telat e sugjeruara. Nuk e diti se çdo re përmban tela të mbytshme.
Propozë.
Joka kerta kun sataa, sataa. Hyötyneet valkaistumassa.
Alltaf þegar rignir, þá rignir arðbærum hvítþvottir.
Every time it rains, profited whitenessing.
Sendingu.
Proposed.
Hilamara in
a casto chronos hue, hue,
kishi.
Sunin.
Κάθε φορά βρέχει και βρέχει. Παρατήρηση
υποφελεί.
Προτινόμενη καλωδίωση. Δεν γνωρίζεις ότι κάθε σύννεφο περιέχει.
Siempre que llueve, llueve blanca testificar, aprovechado, propuesto, cableado,
todo
sabes que cada nube contiene
humedad, progredió, filtração,
chuva,
siempre
que
llueve,
Every time it rains, it rains profited whitenessing, proposed wiring.
Proposed.
Don't you know each cloud contains choke damp chain cables?
Okay, thank you. That's all I'm gonna share for now.
Thank you.
Great, thank you very much.
Amazing. Thanks so much. Oh, you're muted now.
I'm okay. I can see that you're all a little glitchy, so I don't know how smooth that video was or how well you could hear, but hopefully you could hear something.
Mm-hmm. Well, we could hear it. It was, yeah.
Okay, great.
I don't know, was it glitchy? I didn't feel if it was. I thought
okay.
It was, yeah.
Hmm. Okay, great, yeah. So, you know, yeah, I wanted to give like a bunch of context for this. So maybe I gave quite a lot, but particularly for this audience. And just to sort of underscore, it's sort of like the research is actually part of the project. And then trying to figure out like what it means to engage these other landscapes that are not mine, but I feel sort of bound to them, both by virtue of the fact that I'm using this technology, but also by virtue of the fact that I've been like personally touched by being in the presence of a project like this, even when I didn't know it, and kind of having it live in my body and processing that as poetry, because I can't process it in another way, because it's sort of too much.
So from what we understood, you started the project, it's more like a detective with the copper mine, and then continued and then got into the pennies from heaven and continued the project where it reached the translation, and you incorporated that too. And the next step, as you said, is going to be having it on the website that we can, or the app that we can see it. Is there any further stage that this you have planned for this project to go, or?
So the projects, I presented them in a pretty non-linear way. I think as I was working on the book about the landfill that became this book that I read you, the landscape looking poems from, I was also at the same time working with these dancers in New York. And, you know, they were kind of two different projects, but they were also the same project. And my friend Monica de la Torre, who probably some of you know, or all of you or something, she and I had a reading together, and I brought one of these like webs of garbage language. And one thing I like to do is try to read them, because they get all tangled up, and it's actually really interesting to try to read, especially when other people are there. And she was like, you need to put this in the book. And that was something I hadn't even considered doing. So I'm sort of grateful to her for thinking that it was even possible to put it in the book. And I don't necessarily think of the book as being the ideal receptacle, but it was one receptacle. Then the performances were another receptacle. And now there's going to be an exhibition at Snug Harbor on Staten Island in New York next year, with all the ephemera from this project. So essentially with the copper project, there's the pieces that can be published either online or in book form. And then there's the performances, which I have done with my collaborators that also include the sound artist, Mark Booth. And we've actually kind of rethought this performance for several different performance spaces. And then there were also twice we installed it in galleries. And then we're thinking about maybe making an app. So there's not like one output that is the ultimate one. I think I've become like made peace with that, like the idea that the poem exists in multiple forms, and that the book can kind of point toward them without encompassing them. But it actually makes my work really confusing for people. Like some people have seen the performances with the dancers on Fresh Kills, and some people were at Pratt, and some people have read the book, and they're like, wait, but how did this work? And it's actually all very messy, but I now feel like I don't understand how to make work that's just like writing on a page. That somehow the manipulation of these words in space and the thinking about how to write that piece. So the piece in red and black, the red and the black are actually two different voices. So Judd and I perform that together with two iPads. And reading it only as one person actually is kind of weird. And the first poems that I read that are like all the different voices, but in one landscape, those were first performed by multiple voices in Robert Kochik's studio.
Exit 43, you mean, the book with all cut-ups and the images?
Yeah. So those were like performed by multiple people. So now for a while I've done them just by myself, but it's almost not how it was originally conceived. It was originally conceived that it would be read collectively, like by people that I would plant in different parts of the room and say, like, you read the language from this quadrant, and the dancers actually mapped some of those pieces onto their bodies. And when they would activate one part of their body where that word was, they would memorize it. And when they activated that part of their body, they would say that word. And so for me to watch that happening then kind of changed the way I wrote. Just the same way that that red and black piece, the one man drill, was written in a certain way so that it could sort of sound like a musical while also being anti-musical. So, yeah, I
how
mean-
before I we think, get away, how about that piece that they danced? Did you also have sound for that? It was only people's voices, or there are other instruments or anything?
There was a saxophonist named Tamio Shiraishi, who played, but there wasn't a lot of music in the piece. It was mostly vocal and then the sounds of just like the actual props, of the garbage, because it makes a sound. Like when you're on top of a big landfill, I don't know if you all know Fresh Kills Landfill, like some people would know it, but if you're not from New York, it used to be the biggest landfill on earth. But, you know, of course there's others that have supplanted it since then, but like famously you could see it from space, you know, kind of like the Great Wall of China. It was this thing that was supposed to be open by Robert Moses for 10 years. And then instead it stayed open in perpetuity until the residents of Staten Island finally got it to shut down. And then 9/11 happened and it accepted the remains of 9/11. So it had even more resonance then, that site, for people in New York. So to like perform in that space was very difficult actually, and subject to all kinds of constraints and things. So making scores of language and props that could be used and installed there was a really challenging exercise, because you couldn't plant anything in the ground, for instance, because it might, you know, explode practically, because it's a landfill. So,
I know I'm asking the questions, but of course, like other times, if anyone wants to ask a question, please go ahead. But I ask just one more about the sequence of, because I believe your canary piece what is the recent one, no? That you played first.
That is, that's the most recent thing. And it has to do with thinking about the status of the coal mine canary.
We're thinking about mining.
Yeah, so that piece just sort of took on its own life as I thought about non-human voices. And like this work has got me to thinking a lot about breath and air. And birds are affected by pollutants and by climate change more quickly than we are. So they're considered an indicator species. And of course, birds are always associated with poetry in ways that I used to be really resistant to. But if I can think about birds and poetry in a new way together, then that seems exciting to me. So that piece kind of doesn't follow the same exact trajectory. It came out of lockdown when I wasn't able to meet other people and interview people who worked in mines or like go into archives, but I was only able to like look online and going to hear birds sing and like try to distinguish their songs was such a powerful experience that I felt that I had been deaf to before, quite frankly. I think that was an experience that lots of people have had, you know, like that the human contact shut down and all of a sudden all these events in the world that I had just been blinded to were like unveiled. So I've been thinking a lot about the canary in that way, but of course it's also a domesticated species which has its own really problematic history. So I'm not at all finished with the canary. This is like a set of unfinished pieces that I shared with you, especially the very beginning and the very end as work in progress.
But it's very interesting that the last piece is the canary, because you went through all different languages, the language of garbage, the language of, what was the other language that you mentioned in your
the
piece?
The code books.
The code language, the corporate language, and then in one of your pieces, all different languages that your friends translated comes to the play and then goes to the language of the birds. And of course the language of canary always has the silence in it, because the canaries are detecting carbon monoxide and then they go quiet and die. So it has all the languages, and this last piece also has silence in it as a language. That's very interesting.
Yeah, I guess I'm, you know, like I teach environmental writing and activism, and Rachel Carson's work is so amazing to think about because, you know, she died of cancer before she could really enjoy the success that it had had in changing things, in making DDT, you know, in regulating DDT and other things that have been killing off bird species. And so thinking about like, she was a scientist and what she did was dismissed by other scientists. And she had a really hard time when she wrote the book, Silent Spring. The silence in that book refers to the sound of the birds. You know, that the birds are being killed off by the chemical industry. But could poetry do anything like that? You know, it's like, I'm very humble on that point, but at the same time, I don't like completely discount it as a possibility.
Well, it certainly can excavate very well, in a sense. Everything you did tonight was this large excavation, its own form of mining, a better form of mining.
That's a really cool connection. I actually worked on an archaeological dig. I was hired as an interpreter, an unpaid interpreter, but it meant I got to go to Sicily for free as a college student. And that was the most, I would say it ranks among like the maybe the most amazing experience of my life. I excavated a garbage dump, two garbage dumps actually, one Greek and one Roman. I learned about how garbage is such an important historical reliquary, really. And I had a big problem with how archaeology was done, but like the actual, everything about it was so amazing to me. Like I dug a bust of Persephone out of the ground. It was, wow. You know, I was like 19 and I was completely, you know, just my world was completely rocked. Then there were also all these interesting things about that the fact that I was in cahoots, meaning making friends with the Sicilians, meant that I must be leaking information to them. So they separated all the people who spoke Italian and made them work at different parts of the dig. So it was really kind of, I hate to say it, but sort of a neo-colonial enterprise in that site in the middle of Sicily, in an extremely impoverished part of Sicily, where the treasures had been thieved. They'd been looted by grave robbers and then sold to the Metropolitan Museum of Art and the Getty Museum. And those treasures were actually restored to that site 10 years ago. And the town had this total renaissance. So I was working there at the height of these like tensions between the academic archaeological dig and the people themselves, who were like, if I find a bust of Persephone in my backyard, it's mine. It doesn't belong to Princeton or the University of Virginia. So like the whole thing about archaeology was fascinating to me, and it was never simple. It was always bound up in these like weird racist things against the Sicilians and, you know, against townspeople in general who don't understand the value of, you know, antiquity. So yeah, the idea that archaeology, that poetry is archaeology, is one I really share, and that it's a better kind of mining is one that I really like that you just gave me, Chris. Thanks.
I wanted to comment while you were exposing your wonderful projects. I was remembering all the time that there's a book by Dorothea Lasky that was translated in Chile a couple of years ago that's called Poetry is Not a Project. And of course, I don't agree in that, but I was.
I don't either.
Yeah, but I'm. But her essay is like saying that poetry comes from intuition and all that. But of course, I mean, I think it's very distinctive of a lot of, not all, of course, but a lot of contemporary poets are working in projects and projects that, as we said in your case, go. Very far from the book. I mean, it's an app, it's a book, it's a reading, a performance, it's a collaborative project, etc. And every time I think about these questions, because it's something that interests me very much, I think that maybe it's like poets are working more in the way of an artist, or on a visual artist that also researches and combines different materials and all that. So I wanted to let you know, I wanted to ask you if your conception of or working on projects and not just writing individual poems, maybe you also do that, but was it from the beginning of your poetry writing on, or it has been evolving? And in which way do you think or program these projects right now?
Yeah, thank you for that question. So it's funny because I was thinking as soon as you said Dottie Lasky was at the very first, like, okay, second, but very first reading of that Exit 43 work that it was at Robert Kochik and Daria Fain's studio in Bushwick. And I had the capacity to have these wonderful poets reading it all at once. And that's where I met Dottie, actually, and her partner has been one of the people who wrote so beautifully about that work I did with the dancers. So I think, like, I strongly disagree with the thesis that poetry is not a project. I think that, like, when I was a baby poet or something, and I was thinking, like, that you write a poem so that you get it published and so that people can read it in, like, as they're reading the New Yorker, and like they get it and then they move on to like the flash fiction or whatever. I think I was really stymied by that. That's why I didn't go and study poetry. Instead, I got completely lost. I went to live in Japan for 2 years, then I went to live in Italy for 2 years. I was so completely lost because I thought, I don't want to go to Iowa and like write poems about farm implements and talk about how farm implements work. Like, that's not my reality. And I realize that's not how it goes outside the US, but at the time that I was like in college, that's sort of what you did, like if you wanted to become a poet. And I certainly didn't come from like a family. My father was a jazz musician, so that was special, but his voice is in the app singing. But I didn't have any idea how you become a poet or whatever, so I just went and like learned Japanese and got completely confused and forgot the English language. But then, like, I guess I was really lucky to meet Lynn Hajinian, who believes in the value of language as inquiry. And it's somehow by osmosis, like, I picked up the idea that it was okay to work in series. And that it's okay if people don't get it after one piece. And if you force them to commit to the whole thing. Like, Lynn wasn't a direct, well, yeah, she was a direct influence, but let's just say there were things about like Lynn Hajinian's work that just seemed so hardcore to me. Like, we would sit on these really uncomfortable chairs in her house for 3 hours listening to the recording of Four Saints and Three Acts by Gertrude Stein. And without like water breaks, food, just like on these really uncomfortable wooden chairs in her kitchen. And of course her partner is an experimental musician. So there's like this commitment to the duration of a thing that you just see it through and like you just commit to it and you figure out what you can figure out. And my first book had like a number of series in it around the war in Iraq and the idea of public space. And there were different series, but they weren't the same way a project, the way this book, The Republic of Exit 43, was. And Lynn really gave me a gift by commissioning me to write this book. She said, like, I want you to write a book for A. Telos. And the proposition of that press, and Edwin has a book that I love from A. Telos. And the proposition of the press is that it basically asks for poetry that exceeds what looks like poetry. I forget, that's not a very eloquent way of saying it, but like that alters what it means for something to go under the sign of poetry. And so by taking that commission seriously, I made this almost unpublishable thing. And I was like, Lynn, you're gonna kill me because there's, you know, like 30 full color pieces in here and, you know, but she actually ended up committing to it, but just like having a container that I knew could be more than just poetry It actually has like an essay in the middle of it, like a photo essay, and it has all these different pieces to it. Like the whole book becomes this experience. And I'm really committed to that. And the poet that I spent so much time translating, Amelia Rosselli, is also one of those people. She studied serialism and she studied post-Webernism at Darmstadt, and she wrote books in series that are extremely demanding and that like don't make sense. Her name is Amelia Rosselli.
Oh yeah, I know her. She's wonderful.
Yeah, so it shouldn't, like I shouldn't not name her, because she, even though she had passed, she was a massive influence on me. I was translating her work the whole time I was becoming a poet. And it made me just have a very different sense of what a poet, what it means to write a book. And of course, she had a really hard time too. But also what it means to inhabit a language, because she sort of isn't in any just one language. She's sort of in three languages always.
Hey, Jen.
Yeah.
I wonder if you could talk a little bit about, because you brought this up in a few different ways, accessibility as a poet, because pertaining to Attalos and to Lynn, and how she's such a champion of publishing work that doesn't belong necessarily in books. So that was years ago. Now we're in another location with publishing and media and so forth. And you're stretching your tendrils into all these different places, performance and app and all that stuff. About what audience? About who are we connecting with? And how important that is to you, because there's so much data and so much information as a backlog to the project of the poems and the poetry that you're creating, and that poets that create work that live beyond us do. I wonder if there's something to discuss about where we're landing and the need to figure out, is that so important to kind of like understand that as poets we're allowed to reach out and try different things. How do we sustain that? And, you know, I sort of know the answer, but I don't. I'm curious about your perspective on, you know, all these different tendrils that you're reaching out at.
Yeah, that's such a good, like, it's such an important question. And it's something that I'm, I guess, also kind of obsessed with in a way, because I'm like a first generation college student. That's something that it's a new term that didn't exist until a few years ago, but that's what I like. I'm the only person in my family went to college, so the fact that I do all these things, you know, that are so dense is kind of almost a problem for me more than it might be for other people that I, of the sort that I work around, for instance. And there was this kind of breakthrough that happened with the Republic of Exit 43 when it came out at Christmas time in 2016, right after Trump was elected. And my family was sitting around like flipping through the pages, and it's like, they got it. And it mattered to me that they did. And the fact that it was more than just words, but it was also image and performance and so on, like, was a big part of the entryway into the work, I'm sure. And along the way, as I was doing this, like I performed, you know, with Kathy Westwater for all different people, different types of people in different disciplines in New York, but also with my friend Marco Ariano in Rome, in these centri sociali and occupied theaters in Rome. And the people who show up there are like not the literati, you know, it's like a centro sociale is something between a community center and like a squat, and you know, it's just much more variegated than actually a lot of the spaces where poetry takes place in the US. And I really felt like people there were excited about this work. I performed it with musicians, so it was very different, but like we projected those pieces and we performed them in multiple voices. And that also meant a lot to me, that it spoke to people beyond my little community. Cause it's like, I think for the language poets, it was enough to have that community, but for me, it's not. And I think for a lot of us now, like there's a test. There's like the test of the social worth of poetry is being pressed. And I want it to mean something in ways that extend beyond like what my identity is, you know, that people would read it out of because of who I am or something. Like somehow occupying these different modalities makes more entry points possible. And of course there's always kind of like different levels of engagement. So like maybe someone will get the citation, you know, that I'm like citing, you know, Orfeo do Carnaval, and maybe they won't, or maybe they'll get that I'm, you know, making fun of T.S. Eliot, and maybe they won't. But somehow, like, yeah, even like working with birdsong and stuff, like sound, when you start moving into sound, it's just somehow music also. And I think that it becomes more accessible to people. Of course, there are going to be people who turn away because they're like, I don't know what this means. And this is like, you know, way too weird. But that's okay.
That's totally good.
Yeah.
I also love the Canary video had like this sort of lo-fi virtual reality thing to it, which I really loved. I felt like it was like as if I was watching the brush strokes in the painting. That it's not like this digital perfect kind of thing. You can see you through it, see the cage, see, you know, these little imperfections that make it more human. So I really like that a lot. And then you see the collage and everything. It's very lived, you know.
Yeah, there's this video of Bing Crosby that I purposely used for the installation on the Copper Project, because it's like Bing Crosby singing Pennies from Heaven in the film Pennies from Heaven that's being played on a VCR on a television and was somehow digitized. And so it's so messed up by that point that we can actually like inhabit the age of it, you know, and somehow like get that it's Depression era, even if the VCR era is clearly not Depression era. So I'm like really interested in obsolescence, you know, without going into like geeking out too much on glitch and stuff. But in a lot of the pieces, there's like meant to be seams, you know. So, but yeah, thanks for asking the important questions. I mean, I wonder how you think of that for yourself too. I mean, everyone here is thinking about that probably to some extent.
Can I ask a question about Pennies from Heaven? I just Googled it and there's a weird bit at the end where it kind of reverts to nonsense for like a passage. Can you say something about that in relation to the, I mean, were you thinking about that in relation to the kind of code that you were using? Or, I mean, could you say a bit more about Pennies from Heaven? Because it seems to be obviously quite an important part of this project.
Yeah, so you know, the most obvious thing to say is that Penny has come from hell, you know. And there's a prelude to that Bing Crosby sings that he doesn't sing in other versions. It goes, a long time ago, a million years BC, the best things in life were absolutely free, but no one appreciated a sky that was always blue, and no one congratulated a moon that was always new. So it was planned that they would vanish now and then, and you must pay to get them back again. That's what storms were made for, and you shouldn't be afraid for, you know, and then every time it rains, it rains. So it's incredibly dark. And I am like really obsessed with sort of language of musicals. You know, I've been a big fan of Cole Porter because that was like kind of the only art in my family was like musicals. A lot of them are really great poetry. And the fact that this was produced during the Great Depression is fascinating to me. Also, not long after Busby Berkeley's Gold Diggers of 1933, and you know, Where in the Money, and these big show numbers where there are literally chorus girls like with these coins on them, like scantily clad in just coins. It's sort of perverse. And I thought it was actually kind of brilliant poetry that I'm very interested in lyric that works against the presumptions of lyricism, you know, that it somehow turns dark. And I think that's what's going on there. There's also this thing, which is that Bing Crosby was made possible by technology. So the microphone made it possible for you to have a different vocal style. So the croon was like, because he had this microphone, he could sing in a different way. And it could sound like he was really just kind of in bed with you. You know, like he's singing to this girl that he's tucking into bed in the original film. And so there was something very, you know, seductive about that. Prior to that, you would have to belt it out, right? Because there was nothing that would project the voice. So of course his voice itself relies on electric technology.
Like Roosevelt, I mean. In the fireside chats, that kind of intimacy that you get there, yeah, yeah.
Wow, yeah, you know, I've never thought about that, but I have a picture of my family. My family was apparently chosen as like the poster child. Don't ask me how, but because they were Italian, I guess, like that. He was talking to them around the radio. So there's this image of my whole like grandparent, great grandparents around the radio with FDR having a fireside chat with them. So yeah, but exactly, there's this like sense of intimacy. And now we have this intimacy of these, you know, screens and, you know, yet, if we were to think about it all the time, which I do, like what this is predicated on, you would go crazy. It's like the only way Ali was, you know, and then how do you resist it? I'm on the phone with you now, or I'm on Zoom with you now. How do you participate in a responsible way?
Hi, Jen. I just wanted to go back to something that was mentioned previously. Excuse me. First of all, I find the extent of the research just so remarkable, but also the sense of connectivity throughout these works. As you mentioned, from the very devices that some of these works are on to your own human geography, where you were and located next to on a sports field, and how that is kind of embedded into kind of broader geopolitics and capitalism. It's an incredible breadth of subject matter to kind of process and comprehend. And I was wondering, in your process, and you mentioned like poetry and these projects was the way for you to approach this. I was wondering, within that process, was it difficult to know how to process, or difficult to know which form spoke to which aspect of this kind of copper mining industry and these connections made sense? Or was it something that was cathartic and kind of like this, well, it manifested that this was your way of processing?
Thank you so much, because I also realized I didn't really answer. Felipe was sort of asking about that too, and I got carried away and didn't really answer. So thank you. Essentially, at first, when I was in this really intense part of my life where I left the Bay Area, where I had learned about what is environmental justice, and I was involved with groups like BARGE, the Bay Area Research Group in Enviro Aesthetics, which was founded by David Buch, and doing these kinds of derives through these forgotten about neighborhoods. It was so bizarre to go home to New York and then realize, like, I grew up across from one of those places and not have any idea how to research it, because you can't go digging. Like, it's hazardous to your health. It's also prohibited, and it's also overlorded by the mafia, which is like another thing. I'm very interested in the global waste mafia. And so it was a combination of, like, the only thing I could do was to do this virtual research about the thing that was staring me in the face. And the project was always about that irony, you know? So I kind of named it performatively a pop-up opera, an opera of pop-up windows. And then my friend Judd Morrissey, who I eventually met not that much longer in Chicago, was like, I would like to work on that pop-up opera with you. He was a code artist, and I was like, brilliant, you know, someone who can like make this thing happen that I was just being cheeky about. I thought I would kind of declare it, you know, like in the vein almost of a closet opera, you know, a closet drama or something. So it was partly just intuitively, like, I can't write sentences about this. I can only cut up these documents and like take pictures and almost like via bibliomancy try to figure out what the hell is going on. Because all the reports are inconclusive, so they all end with these, it's not determined, you know, and so that phrase like pervades the poems as well. But then with certain things, like with this dialogue that I ended up having over the course of many years with Judd Morrissey, I invited him and Caroline Bergvall to think about these issues together. And we called this project The Data That We Breathe, which was kind of a pedagogical project to think about the poetics and politics of air. And I ended up thinking about all of this through that. But I knew that I wanted to work with someone like Judd because he works with technology. And the idea was, if you could use augmented reality to make people think differently about the spaces that they're inhabiting and like look at the wires and the telegraph poles and then think about them in a different way, then that would be my ideal. So that made sense. Other things just happened kind of by accident. Like I was working on these poems and I met that dancer, Kathy Westwater, and she said, I think your work, she came to the performance that I mentioned with where I was performing with another choreographer. And she said, yeah, I think your work is very performative and I'd like to collaborate with you. And when I saw her dancers like activating parts of their body and articulating words, I realized that these poems were about the body, and I hadn't even realized that before because it was so disturbing to me. But I thought they were about the landscape, but they were actually about our ill bodies. So like you learn things through these collaborations, and sometimes, you know, there's no forum for the thing that you discover beyond that moment, but that has got to be okay. Yeah, so I hope that kind of answers the question. Maybe I've gone on for a long time.
Oh, thanks a lot, Jen.
So I think if there's not other question, we can move towards our final impro. I don't know if I haven't done my homework yet of translating that line.
Oh, but maybe Jennifer can give us a starting point.
Yeah, so
that was that line that we had to translate. Yeah. I haven't done mine.
Yeah, if I can drop in the chat this JPEG file, but basically it's every time it rains, maybe just these lines. Mm.
Every time it rains, it rains.
It rains profited, which is the code word for proposed, and witnessing, which is the code word for wiring. Or maybe, and maybe another thing, if you don't feel like translating that or working with that, would be to make it rain somehow, sonically or visually. I think that would be cool to do together. So maybe we could, if you, we could just start and people could articulate that. Or another way you could do it is you could like scribble the translation if you don't want to say it out loud, then like show it. Thank you, Zoe.
Rain's white.
So we and could just.
Baran mibarad, mibarad, shahad sim keshi, har bar baran mibarad. پیشنهاد سیم کشی سر بار باران می بارد کلماتی
مانگلاویا
به اعجاز هر بار باران می بارد هر بار باران می بارد کلمات سیم کشی هر بار باران می بارد
whitish. Better to know
no, or not. Common del territorio.
Serenadiaeth sir, lynch yn cord, cordata. Nitro nag wyt ti'n gwybod. Mae pob cwmwl yn cynnwyd ag feidd. Polluted sentry pets.
Lenguaje común de la basura. Llueve en el reino.
Nitro Nagoid.
Nitro Craig.
Prophet Head.
I'm Tom Tint.
When you're grim, wise, solid, situation is fairly
ridiculous and tempestuous. Why is being a melancholic weak? Why is damp out of it? Why is carbide? Why is he truckload of secret and unpunished cold? No procession of seasons that was literally on the dawn. Where is the long wait? What do you call that void that invades us?
That's from Nagoids. In good words. Nitro Nagoids, Incubus, Macomo, and Canoist, Incubus,
Señal de mala suerte. Un pájaro muerto en las profundidades de una mina. La fuga incontrolable de las ratas en alta mar. El extraño éxodo de las hormigas. Un círculo dispuesto sospechosamente alrededor del sol. El agónico canto de un gallo en un frío atardecer. El divisar pequeños juegos fugaces que clandestinos aparecen en la inmensidad siniestra de los cementerios. Una pala que se rompe en mitad de la faena. Un pájaro muerto en las profundidades de una mina. Signos de que el destino nada bueno puede traer.
My pennies, or the pennies they lost, the copper. because the copper needed for the cannons. But the copper was needed for the biocides.
هر بار باران میبارد میبارد مثل سیم کشی مثل نقره مثل کلمات مثل باران میبارد من 35
Don't forget to separate your arsenic from your general acids in your recycling. Don't forget to separate your mercury from your lead when you throw away posts.
Confinement begins with confinement. Like worms can help but diving, like death and roots, confinement begins at the moment of undermining the mind.
Grammars and prickers, lighter and much stronger. Pump rods, plungers, rams, valve spindles, studs, and rammers and prickers, lighter and much stronger. Southwark, London, SE.
They say at certain distance underground, it's possible to hear all the sounds of the world, which are just orbits, almost imperceptible. They come from one moment to another, like an exasperating thunder.
Hai la santità dei santi padri ogni volta che piove, piove.
Hellfire. Hope soon to be making.
And we find
ourselves
about how
making good progress.
We find ourselves
hellishly.
Just like don't have I do and I don't leave blank.
Hellkite.
War.
No reputation.
I know I don't make a good word. This is your kind of talking to
notorious for writing exaggerated reports.
It's time for us to meet over.
Helmets is a man who gets paid a commission only if his report sells the mine. Helpless has been able to manage. Helvella has been badly managed. Hematology management. Actual. We will leave the management of blank to blank.
La hora de salvamento de los cinco mineros sepultados en el pique Geraldo III se realizó en un ambiente de nerviosidad. Hubo instantes en que el roce manifiesto que existió entre los obreros y los técnicos llegó a alcanzar ribetes de verdadera belicosidad. No existía acuerdo entre ellos respecto a la forma en que se realizaban las labores. Los 200 mineros estaban indignados. Acusaron a los técnicos de no haber realizado con precisión el vendaje que... existía desde la superficie hasta el caserón donde se hallaban prisioneros los 5 obreros. Midieron 23 en vez de medir 32, que eran los metros exactos de la ubicación donde ellos se encontraban. Erraron por más de 9 metros, y esto fue la causa de que los trabajos se retardaran por más de 30 horas. Debido a esto, debió correrse el chiflón nuevo por una inclinación de 75 grados. En la nueva excavación, que tardó 3 días, se encontraron con nuevos inconvenientes. Roca dura en unos sectores, tierra demasiado blanda en otros, lo que hizo temer nuevos derrumbes.
Investment.
Mibora.
You have a good deal of difficulty with Mibora. The natives.
Mibora.
In this hole.
Mibora. Mibora. Copper lining.
For how?
Mibora.
Well, now we can clap, right? Thanks very much.
Thank you, Jen. That was amazing.
Thank you for playing.
That was incredible. I'm still speechless, Jennifer. That was amazing. We really need to talk. I mean, there's so many things. I mean, you mentioned there, not only about the copper and mining, but I mean, documentary poetics and everything, you know. So congratulations. I'm amazed.
Thank you so much. I would love to talk more. Yeah, and I'm glad that this hellhole that we're like living through made it actually weirdly possible to have this amazing transatlantic, trans-Pacific conversation with you all. I'm really happy about it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jennifer, and thank you very much, Cathal. And I'm very glad that you didn't disappear, Jennifer.
Yeah.
At the beginning, I was really a little unclear about how it was going to happen because my computer was not exactly acting normal, but we wrote it out. We surfed the wind. Perfectly. So thank you for your patience.
From Wayne's in Manchester now. For next week, we have a special guest from Finland. I don't know how to pronounce it, but Juha Valkiapa, invited by Dick Hustrom. So he's preparing also a session as well as Gasal today. So thank you very much, Gasal, also.
Thank you so much.
And see you all next week.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Hey,
Thank you,
Jennifer.
Thank you so much.
Good night.
Thank you, Ghazal. Thank you, Jennifer.
Good night.
Thank you, Felipe. Friends. Yeah. See you next Wednesday.
Take care and stay safe.